أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Lesson number 203 Surah Al-Qasas Ayah number 68-88 وَرَبُّكَ And your Lord يَخْلُقُ He creates مَا يَشَاءُ Whatever He wills وَيَخْتَارُ And He also selects Allah is the one who creates and He is the one who chooses whoever He wants for whatever work He wishes. مَا كَانَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةِ For them, there is no choice. They do not have the choice to be however they want to be chosen for something that they want to be chosen for. No. This right is exclusively with who? With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallahi, glorified is Allah, wa ta'ala, and exalted عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ above what they associate with Him. The word يختار is from the root letters خَيَرَ اِخْتَارَ يَخْتَارُ is to select something. But it is to select one out of many. Why? Because you consider it to be the most خَيْر. You consider it to be best. Many times when we have to select something, when we have to choose something, we have different criterias. Isn't it so? If we want to select something for a particular work, depending on if it's suitable for it or not, we select whatever is best for it. And ikhtara is to select something that is best because you find it best. You consider it to be best. So, وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ Your Lord creates whatever He wills, وَيَخْتَارُ And He also selects whatever He wills. الْخِيَرَ مَا كَانَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَ They do not have any choice. It's from the root letters خَيَرَ as well. And خِيَرَ is the ability to choose something, to select something. So مَا كَانَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَ The people, they do not have the choice to select their appearance, their khalq. They do not have the choice that they should be chosen, somebody else should be chosen. No, only Allah has this right exclusively. Subhanallahi, glorified is Allah. No one can dispute with Him concerning His ikhtiyar. Wa ta'ala, and He is exalted amma yushrikun above what they associate with Him. Remember that this is a Makki surah. And the people of Makkah, they had many objections against the Prophet ﷺ. And one of them was that the Qur'an, why is it revealed on him? There are so many people in Arabia, so many chiefs, so many leaders who are more wealthy, who are more influential, who are more powerful. They're chiefs of their tribes. They're the leaders of their tribes. They say one thing and everybody listens to them. So why are they not chosen? And they wanted, the people of Makkah, they wanted that if there should be a prophet, it should be from amongst the chiefs of Makkah. And if not, then at least from the chiefs of Al-Ta'if. And we learn this in Surah Al-Zukhruf as well. In Surah Al-Zukhruf, Ayah 31, we learn, وَقَالُوا لَوْ لَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِّنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ And the people of Makkah, they say, that why is this Qur'an not sent down upon a great man from one of the two cities? A great man from either Makkah or a great man from Al-Ta'if. So according to them, a great man from Makkah, such as Walid bin Mughira, and a great man from Ta'if, such as Urwa ibn Mas'ud, al-Thaqafi, they were more worthy of prophethood. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was he? An ordinary person. Yes, he was from a noble family, but he wasn't a chief. Yes, he was well off, but he wasn't as wealthy as the rest of them. Similarly, he was an orphan. And he only had one wife. So for them, he wasn't really that great compared to other people. So this is one objection that they raised against the Prophet ﷺ. But what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say over here? That this choice is not with the people. Allah is the one who creates whatever He wills, and He is the one who selects وَيَخْتَارُ And the people مَا كَانَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةِ They do not have any choice. What does this teach us? A very, very important lesson. That when it comes to the khalq, when it comes to the form, the appearance, the face of someone, do they have a choice with regards to that? No. It's وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ. He creates whatever He wills. So who are we to object? That why are my eyes like this? And why is their nose like that? And why is their color like this? We are no ones to object. And if we dare to object, then whose wisdom, whose choice are we objecting at? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is extreme disrespect. Think about it. You select something, you choose something, and other people come and start commenting, why is it like this and why is it like that? How would you feel? Insulted. Isn't it so? Then how is it fair that when it comes to the creation of Allah, we are always pointing fingers? We are always passing comments, harsh, rude comments, whereas the fact is that no person has created himself. Allah is the one who has given them their appearance. So, وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ. And then, وَيَخْتَارُ. Even He is the one who selects. So if Allah has chosen someone for a particular task, we are no ones to object. If Allah has given someone a specific ability, we are no ones to object. If Allah chose Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for prophethood, we are no ones to object. Our job is سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Our job is not to object at the decisions of Allah. وَرَبُّكَ يَعْلَمُ. And your Lord knows مَا تُكِنُّ صُدُورُهُمْ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ. What their breasts conceal and what they declare. وَرَبُّكَ يَعْلَمُ مَا تُكِنُّ. تُكِنُّ is from the root letters كَافْ نُون نُون. And it means to conceal something. So He knows whatever their sudur conceal. Now what's in the sadr? The heart. So whatever feelings, whatever grudges, whatever jealousies, objections, a person has in his heart and he does not utter them, he does not say them out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still knows about them. وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ. And whatever they do reveal. يُعْلِنُونَ عَيْنْ لَامْ نُونَ. إِعْلَان, which is to disclose something. So whatever they hide in their hearts and whatever they declare, Allah knows about it very well. We see that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was chosen as a prophet of Allah, the mushrikeen of Makkah became very envious of him. That why him and not us? Because they recognized his truthfulness. They knew he was not a liar. They knew he was a prophet. And they didn't want to accept. Why? Because they considered themselves superior to him. It was as though they were insulted that they were not chosen and he was chosen. Think about it. From among your relatives, from among your friends, someone is chosen for a very high position. They get a job at a very good place. They're child goes to med school and your child is struggling through university, just trying to complete his bachelor's degree, or you are struggling and they're your cousins, they are excelling. How would you feel? How would you feel? Deprived. You would feel that you are lesser than them in some way. Now think about it. The Makkans also, they had the same problem, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been chosen and they felt that they were being insulted because they considered themselves to be superior and they thought that they should have been chosen, especially their leaders. And this jealousy that they had, they kept it in their hearts and sometimes they also exposed it. And this is a reality, that when someone is jealous of another, that jealousy he cannot completely keep inside his heart. He tries to conceal it, but every now and then what happens? It comes to the surface. So وَرَبُّكَ يَعْلَمُ مَا تُكِنُّ صُدُورُهُمْ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ. He knows whatever they hide in their hearts and whatever they reveal. It's possible that some things they say out and other things they keep in their heart. But Allah knows. What does it show to us? That we should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to what we even keep in our hearts. Sometimes it's possible we see someone and we think that their appearance is very strange, that their eyes are not the way we want them to be. And in our heart we start laughing at them. Oh my God, look at their nose. Oh my God, look at their eyes. And when we're laughing at them in our heart like this, who knows about it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should fear Him. It's possible we don't say anything. The other person does not even find out that we find their eyes or nose very strange. But Allah knows. And He will hold us accountable. Similarly, it's quite possible that someone is selected for a particular task. Someone has been given a position of authority, a position of leadership, a position where they're getting a lot of praise, where they're in the limelight, and we are envious of that. We do not want to accept it. On the surface, we may accept it. We might even go and congratulate them. We might even go and, you know, say good things to them. But in our heart, we are extremely upset. We're extremely angry and furious. Who knows about it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job as human beings is that we accept the decree of Allah. Because there is no benefit in denying it. There is no use in opposing it. A person cannot get anywhere. If you deny, if you don't accept, you become angry, is it going to change the situation at all? No. Is it going to put you in their place? Not at all. Who is going to suffer? You. So for your own betterment, for your own good, accept whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. We learn in Surah Al-Ra'd, ayah number 10, سَوَاءٌ مِّنْكُمْ مَنْ أَصَرَّ الْقَوْلَ وَمَنْ جَهَرَ بِهِ. It is the same to him concerning you, whether one conceals his speech or one publicizes it. You keep it in your heart, you don't say it, or you have the guts to say it even. Allah knows it. Allah knows about it, and He can hold you accountable. وَهُوَ اللَّهُ. And He is Allah. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّهُ. There is no God except Him. Tawheed is being mentioned over here. Why? Because remember that in Makki surahs, Tawheed is one of the main topics, one of the main themes. So, وَهُوَ اللَّهُ. He is Allah, the one who creates whatever He wills, the one who selects whatever He wills, and the one who knows about what we hide and what we reveal. He is Allah, la ilaha illahu, there is no God except Him. No one deserves worship except Him. Lahul hamdu fil ula wal akhirah. To Him belongs, meaning He is worthy of praise, where? Fil ula wal akhirah. In the first and also in the last. Al ula is a feminine of awwal. And akhirah is a feminine of akhir. So, وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْأُولَى. What does أُولَى refer to? Dunya. And akhirah, what does that refer to? The hereafter, meaning in Jannah. So He is the one who deserves hamd in this dunya and also in the hereafter. Why is this mentioned over here? That He is the one who deserves praise in this dunya and also in the hereafter. Think about it. Related with the previous ayat. وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَخْتَارُ. Related with this ayah. What's the relation? What's the connection? When a person does not accept the decree of Allah, thinking that why is this person chosen and why am I not chosen? Why are they so beautiful and why am I not that beautiful? Why do they have so much wealth and I don't have that much wealth? What's the feeling behind that? That I want to be praised. What does Allah say? He is the one who deserves praise. But لَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْأُولَى وَالْآخِرَةِ. That whatever Allah has created, whatever He has chosen, however He has created, He deserves hamd for that. Because the thing is that when we object at the decisions of Allah, at the decree of Allah, are we praising Him? Are we thanking Him? No. As we discussed earlier, this is disrespect. When a person objects at the decision of the other. So, لَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْأُولَى وَالْآخِرَةِ. He deserves hamd in this dunya even. You're supposed to accept His decisions, not object at them. You're supposed to praise Him and glorify Him for His perfect wisdom, for His perfect choice, for His perfect selection. لَهُ الْحَمْدُ. Because if you think about it, one is something that Allah has created, and the other is something that people have put together. What is better? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. One is that Allah chooses someone based on His complete and perfect knowledge and wisdom. And the other is that we choose someone based on our bias, based on our limited knowledge. Whose selection is better? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So lahu alhamdu fil ula, in the dunya, Allah deserves praise. Wal akhirah, and also in the hereafter, when He will reward those who deserve reward, and He will admit them in Jannah, then what will they say when they enter Jannah? That alhamdulillahi alladhi hadana lihada, wama kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. That as people will enter Jannah, what will they say? That all praise to Allah, the one who guided us to this. And had it not been for His guidance, we would not have made it here. We would not have entered Jannah. And we see that in Jannah, the people, they will glorify Allah just as one breathes. That when you breathe, when you inhale, when you exhale, do you find any difficulty? No. It's something that is a part of you. You do it even without thinking. You don't have to tell yourself, okay, inhale, okay, exhale. No. Unless if you're really focusing on your breathing, right? But otherwise, you don't even think about it. Similarly, in Jannah, how will people glorify and praise Allah? Just as they breathe. But that's only possible if a person has been doing the hamd of Allah in the dunya. If a person has been given tawfiq to praise Allah, to praise His creation, to praise His selection, to accept it, to learn to appreciate it, only then he will be able to praise Allah in the hereafter. If in this dunya we're always finding faults in what Allah has made, whether it's in our own body, or it's in the body of other people, or it's in our family, or in the families of other people, this is not praising Allah. If in this dunya we're stuck in this, then in the hereafter, how do we expect that all of a sudden we'll be praising Allah? No. Because people who are negative, who find faults in themselves even, in their bodies even, they find faults in everything. Isn't it so? People who have this negative trait of finding faults, they never find anything good. They will find faults in their children, they will find faults in their friends, in their relatives, all the time this is what they're doing. Their nose is too small, their nose is too long, their nose is too fat, their nose is too thin. All the time they're analyzing people, criticizing them. They're never happy with anything. So there's a complete difference in these two types of people. One who like something, why? Because it's from Allah. Allah made it. Allah chose it. Allah selected it. And because Allah made it, He likes it. He praises Allah for it. And the other is that a person gets stuck in the appearance, and there he starts criticizing, he starts objecting, he will never be happy, he will never be satisfied. So, لَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْأُولَى وَالْآخِرَةِ. He deserves hamd in the dunya and also in the hereafter. وَلَهُ الْحُكْمُ. And to him belongs the command. Meaning it is he exclusively who has the right to decide. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. And to him you all will be returned. When the hukm, when the command, when the judgment, when the decree belongs to him, then it's up to him. Whatever he wishes to create, whoever he wishes to select. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. And to him you will be returned. قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ. Say, have you ever considered that إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ اللَّيْلَ سَرْمَدًا. That if Allah should make for you the night continuous. أَرَأَيْتُمْ. Have you ever thought about this? Tell me, have you ever considered that إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ. If Allah made عَلَيْكُمْ upon you اللَّيْلَ the night سَرْمَدًا continuous. Everlasting. Non-stop. سَرْمَدًا is from the root letters. Seen, ra, meem, dal. Seen, ra, meem, dal. And sarmad is something that is continuous, something that is of endless duration, something that continues to happen without any interruption. Its state does not change. The hal does not change. It does not alter. So it remains in its state unchanged continuously. This is what sarmad is. And according to Imam Razi, sarmad is from the root letter sin ra dal, sarada. Sarada, sin ra dal. And sarada is to continue to flow uninterruptedly. Alright? So sarmad would be what? The meem is from mubalagha, so sarmad would be one that is of endless duration, one that is for eternity. It is flowing uninterruptedly, it is going constantly. So if Allah made the night upon you sarmad, just imagine, never coming to an end. It's always night time. There is absolutely no sun, no sunrise, no morning, no dawn, no break of dawn, nothing. إِن جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ اللَّيْلَ سَرْمَدًا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ Until the day of judgment. That you never saw the light of the sun again. مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ Who is this God other than Allah? يَأْتِيكُمْ بِضِيَاءٍ Who could bring you light? Have you ever thought about it? أَفَلَا تَسْمَعُونَ Do you not listen? ضِيَاء from the root letters ضَاد وَاوْ هَمْزَة And ضِيَاء is used for such light that has heat as well. It has redness, it has light, and it's also a source of heat. So think about it. If Allah made the night perpetual, endless, never to come to an end until the day of judgment, is there any being, is there any God, is there anyone who can bring light to you again? No. أَفَلَا تَسْمَعُونَ Do you not listen? What does this ayah illustrate over here? What does it show to us? The power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What else does it show? That Allah has created a variety in His creation. There is night, there is day. Both are essential. It proves the oneness of Allah. مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ Yes, that whatever Allah chooses, whatever Allah selects, however Allah has made something, it is for our benefit. So why should we object? Oh, why is the sun like that? Why is the moon like that? رَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَخْتَارُ The sun, the day, the night, all of these are what? Great blessings of Allah. So if we start objecting, why is it like that and why is it like this? Then we are being ungrateful for the blessings of Allah. And if Allah wants, He can take them away from us whenever He wants. That this shows to us about the mercy of Allah, that it's out of His mercy that He has made the sun, He has made the day, He has made the night. There are people who even object at the sun. We are completely powerless before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That if Allah has decided something, if Allah executes something, no matter how much we object, is it going to change anything? No. If Allah decides that it should be night eternally, can you bring the sun? Can you bring daylight? No. So when Allah has decided something, our objection, our wanting something otherwise is not going to make any difference. We are completely powerless before Allah. Our job is to accept whatever Allah has selected, whatever He has decided. قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ Say, have you ever considered that إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ النَّهَارَ سَرْمَدًا That if Allah should make for you the day continues. In the previous ayah, what was mentioned? The night. If that was made continuous. And over here, the day is continuous so that there is no night ever. It's always daytime. إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ Until the day of judgment. مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ Who is this God other than Allah? يَأْتِيكُمْ بِلَيْلٍ Who could bring you night? تَسْكُنُونَ فِيهِ So that you could rest in it. Taskununa from the root letters? Seen kafnoon. Sukoon. And if you notice, sukoon over here is mentioned in particular because when do you find sukoon? During the night. يَأْتِيكُمْ بِلَيْلٍ تَسْكُنُونَ فِيهِ So that you could rest in it. Real sukoon is actually in the night. أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ Then do you not see? Do you not realize? Do you not understand? If you think, in these two ayat, two different points are mentioned. In two different ways. In the first ayah, what is mentioned? That if the night was eternal. And in the second ayah, if the day was eternal. And the ayah which mentions the night, at the end what is mentioned? أَفَلَا تَسْمَعُونَ Do you not listen? And in the ayah where the day is mentioned, what is said at the end? أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ Do you not see? Why is تَسْمَعُونَ mentioned with the night? Because in the night, you cannot see. In the night, your vision is limited. And think about places where there's no electricity, where there's limited electricity. Then what happens? A person is unable to see clearly. And what sense becomes extremely sharp? hearing. Remember some time when you woke up in the middle of the night, it was completely dark, or there was very little light, your hearing is much more sharper. Isn't it so? That even if something moves slightly, you can hear the ticking of the clock even, which you don't hear generally during the day. But during the night, you can hear every tick. Correct? During the night, you can hear every movement. So, أَفَلَا تَسْمَعُونَ, do you not listen? And then when it comes to the day, what is mentioned? أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ, do you not see? Why? Because during the day, your ability to see is much sharper. Clearly, you can see more things compared to the nighttime. What does this show to us? That tasma'un is mentioned before tubsirun. Isn't it so? Tasma'un is mentioned before tubsirun. This shows to us that both sam' and basar, both are needed to reflect on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To reflect on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to understand. Seeing alone is not sufficient, and hearing alone is not sufficient. Both are necessary. But listening, it comes first. Listening comes first. And this is why we see that the Qur'an, how was it delivered to the Prophet ﷺ? It was recited to him. And how did he pass the Qur'an on to other people? By reciting it to them. So in order to understand, in order to realize, in order to appreciate the blessings of Allah, we need to listen and we also need to see. Both are necessary. So sometimes when you go outside, you go out to walk or something, don't just spend the time headphones in your ears or just constantly talking away on the phone or constantly talking away to other people. Listen to the beautiful sounds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created as well. Listen to the chirping of the birds. Listen to the blowing of the winds, the ruffling of the leaves. Listen to the flowing of the water. It will make you appreciate the blessings of Allah even more. And tubsirun, see, go and look. Don't cover your eyes. I remember once we were traveling somewhere, and I was very small at that time. It was another country that we had gone to. And I was busy playing with something with my hands. And my mom, she was getting so upset. She's like, you can do this at home as well. Now that you're here, look outside. Look, see, because you won't get this opportunity at home. And that's something that really hit me. That you can do these things at home even. You can play with your dolls, you can play with your bracelets, you can do different things at home. But the things that you get to see outside, you don't get to see them elsewhere. So, both these things are necessary. Samr as well as basar, in order to understand, in order to appreciate the blessings of Allah. وَمِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ, and of His mercy, that جَعَلَ لَكُمُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ, that He has made for you the night and the day. It's out of His mercy that He has created both the night and the day. For who? لَكُمْ, for you, for your benefit. Think about it, if the night was endless, no day, or if the day was endless, no night, how difficult it would be for you to do anything, to find rest, to work, to get more energy. It would be impossible. So it's out of His great mercy that He has made for you the night and the day. Why? لِتَسْكُنُوا فِيهِ, so that you can find rest in it. In what? In the night. لِتَسْكُنُوا فِيهِ, He refers to the night, because notice it's not فِيهِمَا. Alright? So when do we rest? When is the proper time to take rest? During the night. وَلِتَبْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِهِ, and so that you seek from His bounty. And when do you do that? During the day. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ, and so that you all are grateful. What do we see over here? That the alternation of the night and the day, the difference between the night and the day, the fact that there is a night and the fact that there is a day, this is what? A great mercy of Allah. That He has kept this variation. He has made both of them different for different purposes, for different reasons. It's out of His mercy. So why should we object? If we realize that the night is for a reason, the day is for a reason, both are essential, both are necessary the way they are, then other decisions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well are what? they are beneficial for us. They are a source of mercy for us. We might not see it, we might not realize it, but it's for our benefit, it's for our goodness. Every decision of Allah, every decree of Allah, the way Allah has made everything, the way Allah has chosen everything, there is great wisdom and benefit behind it. We might not see it. And the way we can see it is that we should think about it. What if it's not there? Just imagine if I didn't have it. Like Allah makes us realize the importance of the day. How? By telling us that imagine if there was no day. The importance of the night. How? Imagine there was no night. So sometimes people wonder, why do I have a nose like this? Imagine you didn't have a nose. Why is my height like this? Imagine that you were extremely short. Just imagine. People object, why do I have to wear glasses? Imagine if you didn't have eyes. Why is my skin like this? Imagine if your skin was entirely diseased. Just think about it. Everything that Allah has given you, there is wisdom behind it in the way He has given it to you, in the form that He has given it to you. And we have to realize it's out of His mercy. We might not see the positive side, but it's there. Like the night and the day, both of them have a particular function. What's the function of the night? لِتَسْكُنُوا فِيهِ, so that you can find sukoon in it. And the day, لِتَبْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. This shows us a very, very important lesson. That Allah has made the night for us to rest in, and the day for us to work in. Because in order to rest, what do you need? Darkness. You need silence. You need calmness. You need stillness, that everybody else should also be silent. And in order to work, what do you need? Light. Sometimes, you know, if you're working in a dark place with all the windows closed, there's hardly any light, can you work? No. You're working and you start falling asleep. Similarly, in order to work, what else do you need? That other people should be working as well. If everybody else is sleeping and you're the only one working, how do you feel? You can't work. But if you see everybody's working, one is going here, one is going there, then it brings you energy and you can also work. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this beautiful system so that when we rest during the night, we can get peaceful rest. And when we work during the day, we can be extremely productive and accomplish a lot. And if we go against this natural system that Allah has created, if we sleep during the day and we work during the night, is our sleep going to be beneficial? Is it going to be restful? No. No matter how much we sleep during the day, it's not equal to sleeping during the night. Remember that. No matter how much you sleep during the day, it's not equal to sleeping during the night. In the night when you sleep, at the time when your body naturally wants to sleep, and if you sleep at that time, your sleep will be more beneficial. It will be as though you have slept for several hours. And in the day when you sleep, even if you sleep for many, many hours, when you wake up, you're still exhausted. You're not fresh. It is said that the number of hours that you sleep during the night, it's like as though your body has rested twice the amount of those hours. So for example, if you slept for 4 hours during the night, it's as though your body has rested for 8 hours. Why? Because in the night, your body naturally wants to rest. Naturally. And if you sleep for 8 hours during the day, is it going to bring the same rest to your body? Not at all. And on the other hand, if you try to work for 3 hours during the night, you will not accomplish as much as you will accomplish in the 3 hours of the day. Isn't it so? Sometimes it's possible that you're struggling to stay awake during the night to do some work. And you stay awake for an hour or two, but you're dragging through your work and still you can't get anything done. And you wake up after Fajr, you stay awake, you do your work, in 1 hour you can get your work done. Why? Because this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made our system. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set our system. And if we follow the system, only then we can be productive. Only then we can truly benefit from our rest, and only then can we truly benefit from our work. لِتَسْكُنُوا فِيهِ وَلِتَبْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And so that you can be grateful. This ayah shows us another very important lesson, which is that taking rest and seeking the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning wealth, money, this is what? This is not something that is disliked. Rather, it is something that is matloob, it is required. Because Allah has made the night so that we can rest. He has made the day so that we can seek His bounty. Because sometimes what happens to people, if they sleep, they feel guilty. Even if that sleep is essential. There are very few people, by the way, who think like this. Most people, they feel guilty if they're not sleeping. But what do we see over here? That taking rest is not a crime, is not something that is against piety. Rather, it is something that is essential. If you want to be more productive, you need to take essential rest. Because if you don't take rest that your body needs, then you will not be able to work more. You will not be able to be more productive. Remember that. And each person, depending on how their body is, depending on how much work they're doing, depending on how much their body is functioning, the time or the amount of rest that they need could be different. Isn't it so? This is true. That it really varies from body to body. You cannot say, oh, you need 8 hours of sleep. No, some people can make do with 6 hours. If they sleep more than 6 hours, you know, the last 2 hours are very difficult for them. Other people, they cannot make do with less than 8 hours. So every person is different. And whatever amount of rest is necessary for a person, he must take it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, لِتَسْكُنُوا فِيهِ. Because if you don't take the required rest, then you will not be able to function properly. Also, that لِتَبْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Seeking of the bounty of Allah, this is also something that is required. This is not against righteousness. This is not against piety. No, this is required. But what is necessary? That in doing both of these things, taking rest and seeking the bounty of Allah, a person must adopt moderation. He must be on the way of moderation. He must not go on to extremes. And when a person remains in moderation, then that is what? Gratitude. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Because he is taking advantage of the night, of the day, of the opportunities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending his way. We'll listen to the recitation and then we'll continue. We see that when people have these particular standards of beauty, that this part of the body has to be of this color and this size and this shape, then what happens? At the end, whatever they put together is something that is not humanly possible. Like, for example, the Barbie doll, right? That it's supposed to be very beautiful, the hair, the neck, the face, everything. But what happens? If there was a human being with that kind of a body, it would be impossible. Isn't it so? What is said, that the back would not function or something like that? It wouldn't be able to stand. So it's very beautiful, however, it wouldn't be able to stand. So our knowledge is limited. Whatever we select, it's based on our bias. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His choice, His creation is perfect, the way He has created things. And we are no ones to object. Children who are so young, 10 to 13, they're asking if they could get plastic surgery done to alter their ears or alter their nose, because they get bullied at every single day. Because people don't understand that no one selects their body themselves. Allah selects it. Allah creates it. Allah chooses it. And when a person does not accept the decree of Allah, then this is how he insults others. This is how he ruins their confidence, shatters their confidence. People are not happy with their nose, or people are not happy with their eyes, or something or the other. People who do go and get these changes done, whatever they have chosen, it's so repulsive that it's difficult to even look at their face straight. It's difficult to even look at them. They were much better before. But because they were not satisfied with how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created them, and they thought they could do whatever they wanted to, look at the output, look at the end result. This variation that somebody's eyes are big, others they're small, somebody's eyes are very bright and others they're different. This is the variety that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. This is the ayah. This is a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Qur'an that it's of His signs that He has placed His variation in your colors and in your languages, and we start objecting at the differences. If we ever give a gift to someone and they begin to criticize it, they begin to hide it, they're too embarrassed to show it, they're too embarrassed to talk about it, or they start making fun of it, how would you feel? Extremely disrespected. But unfortunately, we do this with the creation of Allah all the time. If we accept the decree of Allah, the decision of Allah as it is, only then we can take benefit. If we accept the night as it is, only then we can take rest. If we accept the day as it is, only then we can do some work and benefit. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ If the mushrikeen had accepted the Prophet ﷺ as he was, who he was, then they would have benefited. So we see that a person can only benefit from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given if he is grateful, if he accepts. Many times we sleep beyond necessary. Why? Out of laziness. And we say that, no, I'm still tired. As long as you stay in your bed, you will be tired. After some time, try getting up, try getting out, and then see that you will be fresh. You will be able to do something different. So sometimes it's laziness, and sometimes we don't sleep on time saying that, oh, other people don't let me. And sometimes we blame the time of salah, whereas the time of salah begins at a particular time, and then we end up sleeping an hour after that. So we have a list of excuses sometimes. But if a person sleeps on time, and he wakes up on time, he sleeps between Isha and Fajr, then this is sufficient. It's not just with the appearance of people, the form of people, but it's also with other creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such as the weather, the snow, the sun, the rain, that people begin to object at. So we need to accept every decree, every decision of Allah as it is. There was a research done a while ago in which they took some people in a place where there was absolutely no electricity, and they let their body clocks function them. And it was seen that during the day people were very productive, and during the night, very soon after sunset, people would naturally want to sleep. There was no electricity, so they would naturally want to sleep during the night. And halfway through the night, they would be extremely awake, and then again they would sleep. And then at dawn, again they would wake up. And it's amazing that halfway through the night, at that time when a person gets up to pray, it's such a great opportunity. And then at dawn, again, a person is praying Fajr. And then soon after sunset, after Maghrib, a person goes to sleep. This is a natural body clock. Because we have surrounded ourselves with so many fake things, or so much work that we think is so necessary, which is why we cannot sleep. This is why we cannot be productive. This is why we cannot do anything. We listen to the recitation. Okay, let's continue. وَيَوْمَ يُنَادِيهِمْ And on the day that He will call them, meaning on the Day of Judgment, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call them, meaning He will call the people, فَيَقُولُ Then He will say, أَيْنَ شُرَكَائِي Where are my partners? الَّذِينَ كُنْتُمْ تَزْعُمُونَ Those whom you used to assert. Those whom you assumed were my partners. While you were in the dunya, you thought that they were my partners. Where are they today? So obviously, there is going to be no response. وَنَزَعْنَا And we will extract مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ From every ummah. نَزَعْنَا From the root letters نُون زَاي عَيْن نَزَعَ نَزَعَ is to remove something from its resting place, to take something out from where it was, and it also gives a sense of pulling something out. So وَنَزَعْنَا We drew out, we will extract مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ From every nation, from every people, from every community. And ummah refers to ummah of every prophet. Who will we take out? Shaheedan, a witness. And who does this shaheed refer to? The prophet of that nation. So the prophet of that nation will be taken out of the nation. And what will be said? فَقُلْنَا So we will say to who? To the people, to the ummah, Hatu burhanakum, bring your proof, bring your evidence. Over what? Over shirk. Fa'alimu, so they will know. Anna al-haqqa lillah, that indeed the truth, it is for Allah. Wa dhalla anhum ma kanu yaftaroon, and lost from them is what they used to fabricate. In this ayah, a scene of the Day of Judgment is described. Remember that in Makki surahs, after the subject of Tawheed, the next most important subject is Iman bil Akhirah. Which is why you will see both of these themes constantly being repeated in Makki surahs. Tawheed and Akhirah. And this ayah in particular, what does it mention? How the hisab will be taken place on the Day of Judgment. That Allah Himself will question people. وَيَوْمَ يُنَادِيهِمْ Allah Himself will question them. فَقُلْنَا هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ And then, it's not just that Allah Himself will question the people, but Allah will also have the prophets as witnesses against their people. Shaheed, the prophet of Allah will witness against the people. He will testify against them in what they would say. That when Allah will ask, that what's your evidence for shirk? Why did you do shirk? Did you do this or not? People will begin to lie. They will begin to refuse that, no, we never did shirk. As we learn, that wallahi ma kunna mushrikeen. This is what people will say. By Allah, we were never mushrik. We never used to do shirk. So when people will deny, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring their prophets as witnesses against them. And their prophets will testify that yes, these people did shirk. These people used to do shirk. The people will deny, but the prophets will testify against them. And not just shirk, but also other actions. Other evil deeds that the people were committing. That when they will be questioned, did you do this? Why did you do this? They will deny, refuse. So the prophets of Allah will testify against them. And when they will testify, then the people will be questioned, فَقُلْنَا هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ You bring your proof. Here is a prophet of Allah who is testifying against you. He was in you. Now you bring your evidence that you did not do anything like that, or you bring an evidence over shirk. So at that time the people will realize that al-haq is only for Allah. Meaning the right of being worshipped is exclusively for Allah. وَضَلَّ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَفْتَرُونَ And whatever they used to fabricate, whether it was with regards to idols, or false gods, or concepts about the Day of Judgment, all of that will be lost from them. We learn in Surah An-Nisa, ayah 41, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا So how will it be when we bring from every nation a witness, and we bring you, O Prophet ﷺ, against these people as a witness? So every prophet will be brought as a witness against his people. In Surah Az-Zumar, ayah 69, we learn, وَوُضِعَ الْكِتَابُ وَجِيءَ بِالنَّبِيِّينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَقُضِيَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ And the records of deeds will be placed, and the prophets and the witnesses will be brought, and it will be judged between them in truth, and they will not be wronged. So what do we see over here? That Allah will establish the truth on the Day of Judgment. That the truth will be established, the people will come to know that al-haq is only for Allah. He is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. We should have accepted His decisions. We should have accepted His decree, His commands. So what do these ayahs teach us? That success lies in accepting what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. Success lies in accepting the authority, the sovereignty of Allah. And if a person does not accept that in any way, then he is heading towards failure. Recitation. وَيَوْمَ يُنَادِيهِمْ فَيَقُولُ أَيْنَ شُرَكَائِيَ الَّذِينَ كُنْتُمْ تَزْعُمُونَ وَنَزَعْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ شَهِيدًا فَقُلْنَا هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ فَعَلِمُوا أَنَّ الْحَقَّ لِلَّهِ وَضَلَّ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَفْتَرُونَ